Good morning, one and all. I, Chaitanya Gaikwad, student manager, Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, have the privilege to introduce our next guest speaker. We have amongst us an eminent personality, Prateek N. Kumar sir, founder and CEO, NeoNiche. Prateek sir started his entrepreneurial journey by founding NeoNiche, which is India's fastest growing marketing agency with diverse portfolio. Known for his sharp business acumen and an eye for detail, Prateek sir has led NeoNiche from one milestone to another, and today the organization is recognized as one of the most innovation enterprises in the country. His greatest strength is ability to pick the right person for the right job, create self-sustaining and profitable ventures, and then stepping aside to let the new leaders take the baton. I welcome you, sir. Please enlighten us with your words of wisdom.
I would be speaking solely from my experience. I think there are much more smarter people in this world than me. I think there are much more smarter leaders than me. I would be speaking from a point of view of whatever my 17 years of career, and out of that, last 6.5 years of being an entrepreneur has taught me. The overarching theme of our gathering here is futuristic trend and the challenges it poses for the B school student, right? So I have tried to create a deck in terms of what, where, and how we will be moving forward. But before we move forward, it is always necessary to remember where we come from. I am a typical 80s child. In our times, Doordarshan was the only broadcaster. We had only so many newspapers. We didn't had something called as internet and broadband connectivity. What we had was what we were taught in the classroom. Today, students have a lot more exposure. The speed of information is that much more faster, and world is changing wee bit faster than how it was happening all this while. Just to bring back a focus, the first slide talks about my company. That's not important. Let's talk about how the world is changing. So in the change landscape, we know that around 6 to 7 times more expensive it has become to acquire a customer. In our parents' time, we would have a typical Kirana Wala, the Modi shop, where we would be buying our goods from, whether whatever is the quality. For years on year, I would remember going to that same Modi shop on the beck and call of my grandmother and my mother to buy sugar, to buy flour, and everything that a household needs. Today, it has become that much more expensive to acquire a customer. Millennials believe that other consumers care more about their shopping experience than actually what the company do. And that's why primarily we focus on peer group evangelism. A typical mobile user today would be checking their mobiles 150 times. And by that, I know quite a few of you inside this room would actually be wondering, actually, do I check my mobile 150 times? So millennials are as likely to follow a brand almost 3 times over their family members. They follow the word of mouth or the brand evangelism, and that's why you have user-generated community which every marketer today are thinking of. Since 2000, newspaper has lost close to around $40 billion in revenue. So that's not how the new generation is getting their news and information from. And around 90% of all internet traffic in 2017 would be video. So what does it depict in terms of technology? Let's pause and take that call. It means that the very way where we were or how we were doing business or existing is going to change. And imperative it is to think, are we ready as institutions, as B schools, to address those change at the speed of light? The half-life of a piece of content today is shorter in 3 hours time. So that means any content that you put out there in the digital platform on a cyberspace, within 3 hours, it says whether that is going to go viral or may not go viral. And this is the most imperative one. Around 40% of the companies that were at the top of Fortune 500 in 2000 are no longer out there, were no longer out there in 2010. Interesting? So what has happened in the last 10 years? Millennials. Young people like you have started becoming that much more intelligent and have started taking the growth of the globe and, more importantly, the growth story of India forward. By the way, how many of you do actually check-in? Facebook check-ins? Very less. We are not moving with the times. So can I get a show of hand? How many of you actually check in? Yeah, that gives me a number. So let's get back to the change scenario. Only 7% of Gen Y work for a Fortune 500 companies now. So where are the rest working for? Yes? Startups. So startups dominate the workforce for this demographic. So there are people like us who come, who possibly have a wildest idea, who are just foolish enough to think that they may succeed. Chances are 90% of the time we fail. We get back on our feet and try to drive the economy forward. So by 2030, 50 billion people will move into a middle class segment. That means they have the power of consumption. The amount of data that is being getting stored currently is doubling every 18 months. And that's why you keep on hearing so much about Internet of Things, about big data analytics, about the entire intelligence being brought forward from user interface and how organization can handle data to understand what their customers want. So let's now look at the futuristic trend in terms of technology, in terms of marketing, in terms of the very way that we are doing business. Digitally, the way web pages are being handled, the way smart apps are being handled is going to change. Direct-to-consumer brands would be focusing as much on offline experience as online interactions and interfaces. Sales and content marketing will become fully integrated. That means it's no more about advertising. It's about creating an evangelism, creating a knowledge about the product that you sell. Social media and digital advertising will take over the more traditional form of marketing. The very fact that event like this will change face and we will move into a more virtual online dissemination of information through live events will become more global. And finally, crowdfunding will become a reality. Now, if marketing is going to change like this, we as students need to understand that there is a gap between ideal that we are learning in our institutions and actuals, what we will be seeing in a real world. So while our institutions are preparing us, they are doing an excellent work of giving us the knowledge that is required to assimilate the information, we can do much better in terms of getting that real world exposure. In terms of technology, hybrid cloud, big data analytics, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, the blockchain, the Internet of Things, these are all slowly becoming reality, right? There are new economic organizations who are already doing mind-boggling research on Internet of Things. They are doing great research in terms of the very way we travel, the very way we experience things. So another big change that will happen is in the area of technology. Customer experience. If you talk about customer experience, around 20 years back, we had limited choices. In the last 20 years, we have been bombarded with choices. There is a clutter out there in market space. For any particular segment of goods, we have around 20 choices. Example, and we are standing in an institution which teaches us about telecom management. 20 years back, we had just one service provider. Right? Which was that? Sorry? BSNL or MTNL in metro cities. How many service providers are there today? There are quite a lot, right? And how do they deliver their services? Through smart devices. How much choices do you have around smart devices? Quite a few. What this means is consumer becomes a king or a queen. It's no more about you can provide anything and hope that, any kind of product would be successful. What has changed this landscape is there would be a lot more collaboration between different organizations, different brands. You see cashbacks being offered on your Ola rides, right? You see cross-promotion being a reality where quite a few group of companies come together. You buy one product, you get a discount on another product. So apart from collaboration, quality offline experiences. Every company, irrespective of whatever business they would be into, would exploit tech to deliver their services. Even the logistic guy or courier wala that comes to your doorstep, your hostel rooms, comes with a smart device to take your signatures. You can clock in where on the transit your goods are. Trust will become the currency that every business will deal in. So integrity becomes a big, big piece of the future trend. Customer has started becoming that much more intelligent. You launch a product, within 6 hours, people are already talking about its virtues and disadvantages. Subject matter expert will become the rainmakers or the actual salesmen. And finally, innovation and focus on connecting customers. Now let's understand the future trend that is going to happen in a workspace. We all have been speaking about drop-in people actually aiming for Fortune 500 companies only, so much startups mushrooming up. And that is and technology taking place, marketing changing, the customer behavior changing. That will also in essence change the workforce and the way we do business. So, bigger change. More and more younger people like you would take leadership position. More and more people would try or strive decision making within those organizations. Smart businesses will move from complaining about the young task force to actually embracing them. The average age of the organization that I work for is 23. It's pretty much the same age group that you guys are. My head of HR is 27 years old and she is managing a task force of close to around 400 people. By the way, another trivia, she is from Pune and she has passed out from a B school in Pune. Flexible work arrangements. The new economy company will give you that much more flexibility in terms of working from anywhere, anytime, for the most effectiveness of the organization. And that's why today you see culture of working from home, you see a culture of flexi timings, you see culture of recharge break. Paperless organization and boomerang employees. So boomerang employees are basically people who would leave an organization in 3-4 years time, and in the old economy arrangement they were not welcome back into the organization. But scenario has changed. If the talent is that effective, they are welcome back into the organization. Average employee tenure within an organization would continue to shorten. I was talking to one of your batchmates this morning and I was telling her that my mom was working for Tata's. And she worked for Tata's for almost 20 years. And that was the norm at that point of time. There would be employees who would be joining an organization, work, toil through it, rise the ladder, and then retire. Scenario is changing. There are so much more opportunities today. The talent is moving faster. The lifespan of an employee within an organization has become that much more shorter. Quite a bit of support services will grow around this ecosystem. You will see more and more arrangements, especially in creative fields, where a freelance model will work. And that's why you see a growth of consultants, growth of freelancers, growth of individual professionals, which was unheard of apart from the field of law, medicine, a few years back. And finally, the startups. The era has come for on-demand services. You pay for what you use, or as much as you use. What this means is, this has provided the large enterprise and the startup the same level playing field. The same, earlier the organization would spend millions and millions, large enterprises would spend millions and millions on marketing budget, millions and millions on creating their IT infrastructure and securities. Today you have organizations like Amazon Web Services, you have organizations like Salesforce.com, which gives you an entire IT infrastructure for pay-per-use or SaaS model. That means today a startup will have the same strength as an enterprise. Non-technical entrepreneurs would enter the top tech field in large numbers. And that's how you see Dawai.com, Makam.com coming into being. There would be more and more e-commerce startup that will come into play for next 5 years, and then there would be a consolidation. We are slowly moving from e-commerce space to e-marketplace. And finally, entrepreneur confidence in the way policy is being outlined in the country will increase more and more as we find more and more governments being ruling the center for 5 years. Niche companies will find success. And you have success stories like Uber, you have success stories like Google, you have success stories like Facebook. Anywhere where the business proposition is unique, which is addressing a real world challenge, providing a real world solution to its customers, will succeed. So what are the major challenges that we are talking about? If you look at all the changes, all the trends that we have been picking up till now, right from consumer behavior to technology to the way we do business to the talent landscape, this is the gap we are talking about. And this is something that three parties need to address: organization, the academia, and the students themselves. Isolation. Currently, we are looking at disciplines in isolation. Honestly, business is not run that way. You have HR, you have marketing, you have finance, but actually these separate disciplines are talking to each other where business are concerned in a real time. Fragmentation and atomization of subject matter, not following the current contextual tools, syllabus not being constantly updated, treat learning as an individual rather than a collective activity. And there are signs that all this are changing. One of those signs is you have industry people coming here and talking to you today. So you should thank your faculty members to make this possible for you. Because this is what and how students understand what organizations need from them. So I was talking about the gap between the ideal and the real. To be an effective manager, to be an efficient manager, and there is a difference between the two, right? What's effective? What is effective? Doing the right thing, right? And what's efficient? Doing the thing right. And success exists in the balance of the two. So as a face of the industry, a face of a business, here are a few recommendations. They are not exhaustive, neither they are absolutely correct in all the areas, but they are some collective of what organizations want from its future talents. Future is more and more about sustainable value for business and society at large. CSR is no more a fact, CSR is a reality. And the very thread of that would lie in domain expertise and integrity. Future is more and more about sustainable global economy. It's not about what we are producing, but how we are producing, which is equally important. So what are the building blocks? Let's look at and be prepared in terms of creating new strategies, steering organization to the right direction, generating funds, building global partnership with the stakeholders. All this and more is expected from any talent in any of the discipline that you would be joining in future. So final gear which operates success. And these are the attributes that we look for when organization goes for campuses. True in the global sense. Positive and winning attitude. The deeper understanding of concepts, application of those concepts in real world scenarios, skills and attribute which is required for life and work both. It's no more about work-life balance. Work is just a part of a larger engine called life. So how would you balance that? It's not possible. It's one attribute, right? Learning is one attribute of life. So what institution like Balaji is doing is changing the landscape for entrepreneurs like us by creating a talent pool where it is more about experiential learning, where it is more about seeing the real world scenarios, where it is more about interfacing with different organizations by way of having interactions like this. So what's trending? Collaboration, problem solving, leadership, co-creation, business ethics, and teamwork. And finally, it's much more about the education that you get within the institution. By the way, these are the five books which shaped my life. You have to find your own best five books. And finally, I'm standing somewhere and talking about failures. We talk about institutions preparing you for success, right? Our parents teach us work hard and be successful. But the world, changing world says we need to embrace our failure. Try 20 things, fail at 19 and the 20th one would be successful. So embrace failure, fail and fail fast. Don't be frightened of any failure. But learn from it. So that's all. Those are the few things from my experiences of working with organizations.
Thank you, sir. Now the house is open for questions.
Sir, you have mentioned earlier that 90% of the startups fail. So from attracting the talent or attracting employees point of view, whenever any individual wants to start up, he wants to go up with a startup, will he have a plan B or will he have a strategy to say for the employees in case if the startup fails?
So when you look at a startup, there are startups which are actually addressing a real world scenario, real solution that I was talking about. And then there are startups for the heck of startup. They don't have a business model. When any talent wants to join a startup, my suggestion to them would be look at the founding team and their background. Look at the business context that they are addressing and then take a call. For if there are startups which will succeed, there are startups which will fail. Even if you fail, by being a part of that startup, you would get a valuable insight in terms of being a part of a journey which will help you in terms of building or being a part of a larger enterprise if you, in case you want to go back to a professional environment.
My name is Divak. Sir, can you please share your journey highlights from being a hospitality graduate to be a founder and CEO?
So, I would say that I am an accidental entrepreneur. And somebody asked me long time back, what is the spelling of entrepreneur? And I said it is spelled as C-O-U-R-A-G-E. Correct. So I started my career with hospitality. I am not an MBA graduate. In fact, I am the most uneducated member of my family where almost everybody is an MBA. So I did my hotel management, joined Taj Group as a management trainee, started working with them. And then realized that I was a wrong person in a right place or I was a right person in a wrong place, either which ways. It was not a right fit. Moved into advertising agencies, moved into event management companies, moved into corporate. My last working as role as a professional was VP of marketing for Accenture. In 2011, I quit my job because I saw that there was an opportunity. The entire market shift was happening. There was a value creation that was possible in the marketing space. There was no single unified voice which would talk to all the disciplines of marketing, whether it is advertising, whether it is PR, whether it is digital marketing, whether it is corporate events. And tie it up with real business or sales. That's when NeoNiche was born. I kind of pulled up 5 lakh rupees. I didn't have any further money. I borrowed my wife's printer and a laptop. And by the way, she is also an MBA. So she borrowed that from them. I got my four co-founders, told them very categorically that I don't have money to pay them for first year, neither I would receive any salary, but I can give them equity. And that's how the business was formed. In fact, the first business that we did was for an IT company called SAP. I think all of you know they are into ERP solutions. And we had exactly, I had 15,000 rupees in my bank account left. I didn't have money to pay the rent. We were pitching in for their business. We were pitching in for empanelment with them. And finally, I had to tell them. So they were negotiating across the table. And they wanted to reduce the cost. And we knew that to give a value for money solution, we cannot reduce it further. So we took a bet. I had to finally tell the head of marketing of SAP that, look, this solution will not come so cheap, but don't give me a work order. After the work, if you think we haven't done a work well, and if you think we have done a work only worth ₹1, give us a work order for ₹1 and we will raise an invoice for that. And that business helped us in creating a turnover of 10 crore in our first year itself. Currently, NeoNiche has, his group is comprising of four companies. NeoNiche is an umbrella brand which deals in marketing solutions for corporates. We have clients like Amazon, Google, Gartner, Ford. So we have close to around 200 plus clients. We have sister concern called Live-O-Live Technicals, which is into technology solution of AR, VR, app creation. We have a company called Greenbox Promotion, which is India's first B2B loyalty program company. We have a company called Greenbox Entertainment, which is into entertainment, event management, and wedding planning. The size of the company today is 63 crore, and that's the revenue that we are churning out. And the office is based out of Bombay, Delhi, Bangalore, Chennai. We have close to around 200 plus people working for us in direct employment, and we have close to another 80, 90 people on contracts. That's what NeoNiche is all about.
Sir, my name is Sagar.
Hi, Sagar.
Hi. You might have seen that there is a consolidation going on in e-commerce industry and telecom industry. And recently, what I've read about Amazon was, Amazon has pledged $5 billion investment in India. Mm-hmm. So, as a startup, how could you take on these giants such as Amazon and again the Alibaba's back Paytm, because they are also coming with this Paytm mall. So, how could, as a startup, could you take on this competition?
Sagar, right?
Yes.
So, Sagar, we have to understand the Indian landscape in terms of business. Look at Indian business and you will see that we are copying the best in our business model. You will see e-commerce space, people are copying what exactly Alibaba and Amazon is doing. You look at Uber and you see somebody is copying it in India. If you start looking at business model from unique perspective of the diaspora that India provides, we are fragmented into states. We are fragmented into different cultures. We are fragmented into different demographics. That means our challenges differ from geography to geography. If we are trying to copy business models, there would always be a challenge where a biggie will come and devour our business. If we look at unique business proposition, for example, shadi.com, right? That was a unique business proposition. That changed the landscape of somebody who would reach out to the matchmaker auntie or the panditji. From that, it took up that responsibility and brought it on the digital age. So that was a unique business proposition, and that's why it's still flourishing. Look at business model that Future Group holds. They brought the multi-specialty brand retail for the easy access across India. That was an innovation. So more and more, if we come from a space where we are talking about innovation and solving a real world problem, I don't think anybody can challenge us.
My question is, how acquisition from other company or other big company can be beneficial to a startup, or either a small startup will be alliance with with your startup can help? Which is
right.
Preferable?
So we have to understand the funding proposition, the entire funding proposition. Why would you ask for a fund? As I said, the entire business diaspora is changing. You have to scale fast. While there are some business model or startup founders who think that they will create a business and quickly get a funding and an exit route and make their money, is the wrong proposition of merging with a larger enterprise. And startup should look for funding if they want to scale up. To scale up fast, they need funds to reach out to new geographies, serve new demographics, and to serve new markets, it's always better to align with a partner who have a larger partner or larger entity who has a capability of doing that, or when it becomes a part of a larger scheme of things. So in that sense, for example, if I have to merge with a larger enterprise, I will see what are the values that they are bringing in. Possibly for me to be a global enterprise, it will take that much more time. And if you look at 90% of today's large Fortune 500 companies of new era, they have grown by via funding, because that helps them in terms of having that extra money to reach out to extra market. Hope that answers your question.
Right, sir. Thank you.
By countenance of Sri Balaji Society, I convey my heartly gratefulness to our guest, Mr. Prateek N. Kumar, sir, for sparing his valuable time to guide us for a successful career. We are greatly encouraged by your gracious presence and immensely benefited by your inspiring words, especially where you mentioned about the humongous transformation from then and now, dawn of digital world, changing futuristic trends and startups. The way you explained the topic of marketing practices, role of social media, difference between epitome and prototype, and the mantra of success were winsome learning for us. Sir, your years of research, your depth of understanding, and your ability to present the subject in such an interesting way are inspiring doors for us. I need to multiply thank you worth 1,000 times to match it with your efforts. If time is money, then today you have spent million for us. I would also like to thank our beloved Bala sir for his guidance and providing such a stimulating and learning environment. Thank you so much.